And now, from the great state of Mississauga in Ontario, Canada, it's the Ted Wallachin Podcast. Brought to you by Tom's Place, for the finest in men's fashion. Tom's Place will suit you. And ETP Canada, providing estate administration with ease. ETP Canada. And now, here's Ted.
Thanks so much, Becky, and welcome, everybody. Thank you very much for being with us. And if you're a first-time listener, we hope you enjoy it, and we hope you come back again. And we invite you to jump on our website at tedwallachin.ca. That's www.tedwallachin.ca. And you can check out some of our podcasts from the past and leave a comment or two. We appreciate that. And whether it's positive or negative, we can handle it. You know, there's a fascinating documentary which is currently airing on a number of specialty or at least streaming channels called The Real George Michael, Portrait of an Artist, which chronicles the life and times of a man who during his career won 2 Grammys, 3 Brit Awards, 12 Billboard Music Awards, and 4 MTV Music Video Awards, while his albums sold more than 120 million copies worldwide. He was also a very generous philanthropist and LGBTQ rights campaigner. 'Cause I gotta have faith. Joining me right now is his music manager and the director of The Real George Michael, Simon-Napier Bell. Simon-Napier Bell, let me welcome you to the program, and thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us. I truly appreciate it. Number one, actually, that should be number two. Number one, fascinating work on the documentary. It's compelling. It's just mesmerizing. I was stunned to find out how successful George Michael Kerr was, and I think a lot of people would be as well. 120 million albums in sales and albums. That is outstanding.
It was extraordinary, wasn't it? Yeah. And one of the really extraordinary things is that Faith, which was this massive album, which had 5 number ones in America and sold hugely, wasn't very, very big in the UK. And it was after that the UK sales kicked in, which shows that strange contrast you sometimes get between the American and the UK markets. But huge artist. And it's fascinating because making that movie, I really had to research things which I hadn't done before. Like, I had to reach out to a lot of his fans. And he has this vast fan club, and probably over 100,000 people in one or another George Michael fan club. And the vast majority, and they're not young now, they're all in their 40s and 50s, huge number are working in medicine, mental health, in as nurses and things like this. He obviously attracted people who were interested in the problems he had, were a fundamental part of what was attractive to him.
Yeah. What is truly amazing is George Michael first came to our attention as part of the duo Wham, along with his partner Andrew Ridgeway, originally. And within 2 years, they recorded 2 albums. Both of those albums were bestsellers, the number one on the UK albums chart and Billboard 200. Is that a good or a bad thing in your opinion as a music manager for a career to start off?
Well, you always have to look at people like the Beatles and say it's a tough act to follow, and you've got the rest of your life. I do think, I mean, everyone has to gauge their own idea of what life should be about. I'm quite old now. I do think it's quite nice to feel that you can build up and you've still got something good to come, or even the best to come.
Yeah.
But George looked at it a different way because he saw music at different stages. So Wham represented, if you like, teenage music or youthful music. Mm-hmm. So it didn't matter that it was huge. That wasn't going to hurt him in the future because that was 2 albums of youthful music. Then he could move on to something which is slightly different. So I don't think that was a bad way for him to start. But some artists, you see them have this enormous success when they're young and they just can't match it again. And it destroys them. They don't become happy people at all.
I mean, how old were they just at this point? 19, 20?
Well, when I started with him, he was 19 and Andrew was 20. So they had their success. You know, it was over by 22.
And why did they split up?
I think I mean, in George's case, they always, George had this incredible ability to plan and look ahead and decide how his career was going to run. Mm-hmm. And so that every single which came out by Wham was looking at the market and what, how they wanted to broaden the market, what would come next, what's the best way of building. And he had always thought he would run Wham for 3 or 4 years with 3 albums and then move on to being a solo artist. And he's going to use Wham to build the right persona to be a solo artist. But it then happened in 2 years rather than 4. And it was definitely the pressure. It was an internal pressure. I'm sure it's to do with being gay. And he felt, you know, Wham's image was so essentially a straight image. You know, it's like Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. It was a classic Hollywood bromance. And he knew it was an act from the beginning. So there wasn't any point in coming out and destroying the act. If he was going to come out, let's finish Wham and I'll come out. I think that was his idea. And then eventually he found he just couldn't go on with it. He the pressure was too great. Too many people were saying or suspecting he was gay. So he finished it. But he didn't come out. Then he fell prey to his own sort of ego. No, I want to be the biggest star in the world. So at the moment when he should have done what he planned to do, he then went on to become the image he had in Faith, which is an even more macho image.
Yeah.
So he was condemned to doing something for another 2 or 3 years. And at the end of that, he was really in a bad way. He was very, very unhappy with it. And, I mean, you probably know the story. And after Faith, he just decided he couldn't go on being this sort of artist. And he refused to promote the next album. And he refused to promote it. He didn't want to appear in videos. He didn't want to continue to push this image, which wasn't really him.
As a young boy, and this becomes evident as you watch the documentary right from the outset, that he talks about, he has these huge dreams that he fears will never be fulfilled. So he goes about creating a man in the image of a great friend. Explain to me what that means exactly.
Well, you know, when he met Andrew, George went to school. He was 11 years old, went to a new school. He was slightly podgy, curly haired, big, ugly glasses, very, very unable to mix with people, didn't have any social graces. And he came into the classroom and all the other students laughed. And the teacher said, who's the new boy going to sit next to? And Andrew put his hand up. And Andrew was the lad about the classroom. You know, he was the good-looking one. Everybody aspired to being like Andrew. And he'd volunteered. So George sat next to Andrew. And from that day on, he was copying Andrew. He saw Andrew as, this is my way into doing other things, to being somebody else. And so when Wham started, it was very much a double Andrew. It's, you know, the real Andrew and the copycat Andrew.
Mm. When he was a student, a young student, was he George Michael or did he?
No. He had his Greek name, and his nickname was Yog, which was short for the long Greek name he had.
Yeah.
No, he didn't become George Michael until after Wham started, actually.
Right. Because he pronounces the name in the documentary. It's actually quite funny where he says, my real name is...
My name is Yorgos Kyriago Panayotou. That's really how it's said.
It's wonderful.
Yorgos Kyriago Panayotou. To the outside world, I am and always will be known as something else, but it's not my name.
And I watched it over and over several times, and I tried to repeat it. Because I thought I would impress you, and I thought I'm not going to do this because I can't.
You would have done, because I still can't do it after all this time.
No, there's, I think it's every letter in the alphabet is used up in his name.
Well, lots of Y's, N's, and G's.
Yeah.
When they became Wham, they got the record contract. No, he's still using that name.
Right.
And it was just after Wham started, and they said, look, you've got to have an easier name. And he came up with that.
We talk about, in the documentary, he talks about how they had this record deal and they were selling all these records, but they weren't making any money. This is a concept that is foreign to so many people. I've worked
in the American music industry invented it.
Well, exactly. It's not foreign to people in the industry or who surround the industry, but to others, they think, well, how can this be possible? Explain that. How it is possible.
Well,
how
record companies, they've got a bit better now, but only a bit better.
Yeah,
but record companies traditionally came from a corporate area, which was you made the maximum profits. And you got people to sign contracts which gave you those. And the contract they signed had a few little, you know, things in it which an experienced person would pick up, and they didn't. And one of them was they would not get paid royalties on 12-inch singles. And, of course, if they'd asked about that, the person asked them to sign the contract would have said, oh, well, they're just promotional or something like that, you know, to push away the query. But the fact is, in the 80s, the thing which sold most of everything in UK was 12-inch singles, which were extended version of current hit singles put out on coloured vinyl, beautiful pictures and things. And they were selling, they must have sold a million each of five or six records, and they weren't paid royalties on them. And they weren't selling anything else, so there was nothing else they were going to get money from until the album came out. And so they had 6 months of being stars with hit records and not a penny coming into them.
And talk to me about their trip to China, because that was quite earth-shattering. For a lot of people, I mean, shocking, really.
That was a shortcut to America. When my partner and I sat down on our first proper meeting with them, which is in a restaurant in London, George said, we want to be the biggest group in the world in a year. That's what you've got. And I just laughed. Nah. A naive kid. I said, look, the biggest group in the world has to be the biggest group in America because that's 60% of the world market. And no one's ever done it, ever, in less than 3 years. Even the Beatles took 4 years. And you can't do it. And the only way to do it is you go to America and you tour, and then you go back and tour a slightly bigger tour. There isn't any national press, any national newspapers in America, or there weren't then. There wasn't really any national coordinated television because of the time zone differences. You have to go backwards and forwards and take your time. And he said, no. He said, you've got a year. Typical, you know, arrogant kids. But arrogant kids are very important things because that's what makes pop stars. If they don't have that, they're not going to be stars. So I looked at my partner, Jazz, and I said, well, what are we doing? Jazz drank a bit more wine. And he said, well, he said, you know, if you were the first Western pop group ever to play in communist China, that would probably get in all the papers and all the newsreels. that could break you. And I loved Asia. I mean, I've been in love with Asia for years. And so I said, yeah, let's do that. And we looked at George, and he said, yeah, fix it. Well, 2 weeks later, I was in China with no invitation and no right to travel alone, sitting here in my hotel room thinking, who in the world in China, who in China could actually say, yes, this group can come and play there? And I thought about it and thought, there's only one man, and that is Deng Xiaoping, who is the president of China. I have to go and talk to him. That's quite a tall order when you're a non-Chinese speaking in China on an illegal visa, because I hadn't been given a proper visa. I'd sneaked in through Hong Kong. And so the next 2 years, that's what I did. I went back and forth to China, finally getting that permission, that invitation from him.
And was that the gateway to the United States?
The week before we played in Beijing, I'd flown into Los Angeles. And that week, Careless Whisper had come out, and it was a hit. And the guy at immigration said, so what do you do? And I said, I manage a pop group. And he said, anyone I heard of? And I said, Wham. He said, no, I never heard of them. And I said, well, they've got a hit right now. It's in the charts. And I sang a bit of the song. He said, oh, yeah, I've heard that. Yeah, what are they called? Wham. Nah. Well, good luck anyway. The week after we'd played in Beijing, we'd been on CBS, ABC, NBC News 24/7 every hour on the hour for 7 consecutive days. And I flew into New York. And the guy said at immigration, what do you do? I said, I manage Wham. And every immigration officer left their post and ran to me and said, you got any photographs, you got any records, you know, left all the tourists queuing to get in. That's what happened from that week in China. And 4 weeks later, we were booking a stadium tour and they played it. And that was 20 months after we started managing. Not the year George wanted, but quicker than anyone else had done it.
Yeah.
In fact, when we played the stadium tour, we finished with the gig at Los Angeles Racecourse, 80,000 or so people. And at the end of the gig, we were all in the dressing room after this wonderful gig, and they'd played three encores. And suddenly the door burst open, and it was Elton John. And he said, you bastards, you did it in 2 years. It took me 6. So that felt good.
Once Wham had disbanded and George was on his own and finding great, great success, how did that change him in terms of his perception of the industry? And because he's now going out on his own.
We're talking about the period of the Faith album. Well, like I said, the first thing is he was very uncomfortable about being gay in the Wham image and getting pressure from the press and not being honest. He's a person who sets great store by being open about everything and being honest. And so he realized he got himself into a trap here. But having done it, he is absolutely determined he was going to get the maximum out of this album and become the biggest star he could. He wanted to outsell Madonna and Michael Jackson. And he did outsell Madonna in the end with that album. But he had never really thought about how lonely it would be to be touring by himself without Andrew. You know, Andrew and him were incredible friends. And everything which went wrong, they could have a laugh, they could joke, they could have a few drinks. Suddenly he was alone in his hotel room every night. You're a star like that. You can't go out. You can't stick your head out of the door without getting mobbed and screamed at. And so it was 2.5 years alone in hotel rooms and limousines. And we put people in solitary confinement as the worst possible punishment they could be given. But that's sometimes where rock stars are. And that's where he was for 2 years, with one little release every night for 1.5 hours on stage where everybody screamed, and then back to the cell.
And he's still a fairly young man at this time.
Very young. That's what I mean. Because when people are 40 or 50, they've done it all their life. They say, right, I'm going on the road. They know exactly what's going to happen, what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. They take videos and they have phone calls booked for their family and friends. George didn't even have that. I mean, it was an age before phones were so easy to use. And it really was. It let out for 1.5 hours. It's like the walk around the prison yard for 1.5 hours and then back to the cell. And it drove him mad. I mean, at the end of that tour, he was in a bad way.
He took a lover, Anselmo Filippa, I believe. Yeah. Am I pronouncing that correctly?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Who eventually died from AIDS. What was known about him and what was known about their relationship at that time? Because
George, coming out's a strange thing. People talk about coming out as a big event. It's not. It's a series of lots of small events. You tell your best friend. George had already told Andrew and the two girls who were in Wham way back when he was in Wham. But bit by bit, you let more people know. And what George didn't like was the idea of telling the press and the media and a lot of whom suspected he was gay. He didn't want them all bouncing and said, we knew it. We told you so. And he didn't get on very well with journalists. He didn't want to give anyone that, you know, the thrill of being able to say, George has told me this big secret. So by the time he met Anselmo Filippa, most of his friends, well, all his friends, and most of some of his family already knew he was gay. And so when he met Anselmo, he just fell in love. And when you fall in love, it's not a great moment to try and conceal things. I mean, it's almost impossible, isn't it? And so he said, come round on a tour with me. Well, immediately that happened. He couldn't conceal how he felt. And so all the road crew understood, and nobody minded. I mean, I don't think anybody, by the middle of the 90s, nobody did mind about this, and certainly not the entertainment business. So he had Anselmo with him going round. And so now all the road crew knew, all his friends knew. He still hadn't told his mum and dad. And then he had this incredibly awful news, that Anselmo had AIDS. And in those days, that really meant it was just a matter of time. There wasn't a matter of, will you die or won't you die? Everyone who had AIDS died. Right. And then you're living not only with that, but the knowledge that you too might have it, So this is not an easy time to get through. And then sure enough, that is what happened. And as a result of that happening, there was nothing left to bother concealing. So he sat down and wrote a letter to his mum and dad, telling them, that he was gay and he'd never told them. And of course, like mums and dads usually do, they reacted very well. All this worry he'd had for 5 years previously that he couldn't possibly tell them. I mean, they just wrote back and said, doesn't matter at all, we still love you, and all the things parents usually say. So he'd hurt himself unnecessarily for all those years. But that's what a lot of young gay guys do.
But he went through a very, very painful moment. He's telling his mother that he's gay. His mother's very accepting, which makes him happy. And at the same time, she's also telling him that she has cancer.
That was a bit later. That didn't happen then. No, I mean, first of all, they were very accepting. And his dad, too, who he absolutely was sure his dad would hate it. No, the chances are they knew. I mean, parents do know about their children, don't they? And they see and they hear things. And his dad ran a restaurant. Who can run a restaurant without gay waiters? I mean, his dad must have had gay people around him all his life, you know. But, you know,
sure.
His children don't always think like that about their parents. But when he told his mum, that was a happy moment. I mean, in the middle of a great unhappiness, that she was so accepting and his dad was too. But the cancer thing came 3 years later when he was beginning slightly to get over it and met somebody else, Kenny Goss, and started an affair with Kenny Goss, and he was wonderfully happy. You know, he had a new friend, and this time he was hoping things had changed. Nowadays, by then, people already were not dying of AIDS. And he'd already told his mum he was gay, so he's able to call up and say, look, mum, you know, fantastic, I've met this young guy and I've fallen in love. And so that was the moment when she said, well, that's wonderful, we're so happy for you, and then, by the way, I've got cancer. And it was always a bittersweet moment. Everything was always one good and one bad.
Yeah, because of the fact that he was gay, and that eventually he admitted it, and that he lost a gay lover to AIDS, that affected him in a number of different ways. He did. He was an advocate for the gay community, and also helped raise a lot of money for HIV/AIDS, including something called the Terence Higgins Trust.
I used to be in charge of the fundraising for the Terence Higgins Trust, biggest AIDS charity around. And I used to have these little dinners. I'd have these big gala ones, but I'd have little ones for the big names. And I remember one where Mick Hucknall and Dave Gilmore and George, and we were in the little downstairs room at Carluccio's, and I told them about what Terence Higgins Trust needed to keep going, what the work it was doing. And everyone around the table was being extremely generous. And George said, I was thinking maybe not just sort of really write you a check, and my heart slightly sank. But no, he said, I've got this new album, this best of, called Ladies and Gentlemen, This is George Michael. And I thought maybe you could use the UK residuals from that. I said, what do you mean? You mean the money you earn from it? He said, yeah. I said, all of it? He said, yeah, but could you mind, don't tell anybody. So I wasn't allowed to tell anybody. I can tell it now, and people know what an extraordinary man he was.
Well, you know, that album sold six, seven million copies, and that's probably 15 or million or so pounds. I mean, George was always on a good royalty. An incredible piece of generosity, extraordinary.
Ted Walshen returns in a moment.
You know, June is birthday month at Tom's Place. We celebrate all month long. Tom's 67th birthday is June 7th. Annette's big day is June 9th. And finally, Tom Jr. celebrates on the 13th. Throw in Father's Day and Canada Day, and you've got a month-long party. We know how to celebrate with birthday deals like 100% wool suits from $167. Selected dress and casual pants, along with shirts, just $67. Sports jackets starting at $167. Plus, many more deals all month long. Don't just be a spectator. Get in on the fun. Join the party and head over to Tom's Place. They're located at 190 Baldwin in the heart of Kensington Market. Give yourself a present this June with a birthday deal on men's brand name business attire. The Tom's Place June birthday deals have been extended one more week. Tom's Place will suit you. Have you been tasked with the role of estate executor, or expected maybe in the future you will be? Well, if so, let me make your life a lot simpler by introducing you to my friend Debbie Stanley. Debbie is the founder of ETP Canada. They specialize in estate administration. Their goal simply is to help Canadian executors understand their role and how to deal with a loved one's estate. Let's face it, there's no school for this, but ETP Canada offers services such as executor support, estate accounting, and they have a new online course called Executor Ready. It's an engaging video designed to make estate administration easier and affordable. And those are two comforting thoughts during a stressful time. So call Debbie Stanley at 1-866-309-0387. That's 1-866-309-0387. Or you can get her at info@etpcanada.ca. That's info@etpcanada.ca.
Now back to Ted Walshen.
he was the anti-philanthropist. I don't know if that's correct. He was the quiet philanthropist. He didn't want. He specifically said, "I'll do this, but please do me a favor. Don't tell anybody."
Yeah, I mean that's very nice and honourable, isn't it? I mean, I'm always suspicious of people who are known as the greatest philanthropist in the world, or you know, you read every day how much this person or that person has given away. I think it's very nice when you don't know. Like you know, and we're going back to Wham again. There was a time when George announced that all the royalties from Last Christmas were going to go to charity. Mm-hmm. And I had to object as the manager and say, well, you can only give your own royalties. You can, you know, there's Andrew and there's you and there's the publisher and there's the managers and everybody can give what they want, but you can't just override them. It's the wrong thing. And George understood that. He said, I'm sorry. I jumped the gun there. So we talked to Andrew. Unbeknown to us, Andrew would be giving royalties from all sorts of things to charities as well. So he also had this thing of wanting to do it under the radar. So it's in both of them. It was something you perhaps it's a British thing, you know, that we think you should do it quietly and not boast about it. But George did it endlessly. I mean, he later on in his life when he found himself sitting watching television a lot, he'd just see things on television. Somebody wanted an operation or, you know, has a father was dying or needed some urgent medical attention or just wanted some new teeth or a pair of glasses and couldn't afford them. And he'd just get on the phone to the television station and say, give them the money, you know, but don't tell anyone I'm doing it. And he'd done this, nobody knew. So he'd done it absolutely countless times, over and over and over again.
Why do you suppose he was so generous? Because he didn't grow up impoverished necessarily, and sometimes that works in favor of people's generosity later in their life. I mean, he grew up in a middle class family, I guess you could say, right?
I think he had a great social conscience, and part of that was a sort of guilt that all he was doing is what he wanted. He loved writing music and he loved performing music, so he was doing what he wanted, making more money than he deserved. I mean, he did. You know, he doesn't see why doing what you want should make you earn you more money than doing what you don't want, or even earn you more money than somebody else is doing what they want. He suddenly found himself with hundreds of millions, or at least tens of millions, and, you know, he was well aware life doesn't cost that much to live. I mean, okay, live however you want, and you're spending $1 million a year or $2 million a year. You don't need the other big chunk of money. And he was also always convinced that he could earn more. He was absolutely certain that whatever he spent didn't matter because he didn't think he'd ever dry up creatively. And so he really had no thought about those money. He really gave away an awful lot of money, not just to charities, but to his family. I mean, there were probably 30 or 40 people in his family who got some sort of help or support or something from him. Mm-hmm. He didn't really care at all about keeping money or saving it.
There was a time where there was some discussion about the direction that his career was going in, that perhaps he became too sexual or too sexualized, too gay, and that became a concern for him.
Not for him. He wanted. The point. I mean, I agree. This is a difficult situation. He was totally open about being gay. So some people would argue if you're completely open about it, you're not being closeted. There's no need to push it so hard in your work or in your videos. Mm-hmm. You're not having to right a wrong. I mean, you're living openly anyway. He didn't do it all the time, but he got these sudden urges to do something. He did that video for a song called Freak, you know, and it really was sort of hard, kind of hardcore porn, but it was hardcore gay clubbing, a sort of area which most gays themselves don't much aspire to. But I'm not sure if that was a thing he felt he needed to do or he just thought it was fun to do. But everyone said you shouldn't do it, and he did do it, and it didn't really do very well. But it didn't hurt him much because he then came back and did something which was much more ordinary. But he liked pushing the boundaries and doing something very different. I mean, if you say compare it with Elton, he's been equally out about being gay. But he's never in his music pushed anything as being gay, certainly not to the limits of being gay, where even other gay people say, I don't like that stuff much, you know. So it was, yeah. it was a, oh, you know, a lot of artists are like this, aren't they? They want to test the public. They want to test everybody. It's not an unusual thing in art.
He ran into some difficulties later in his life with the authorities. He was arrested for a public lewdness, which to many people looked like a setup, entrapment on the part of the police. And I think he referred to an officer in a washroom, he said, who was, quote, waving his genitals at me. And he laughed.
It was definitely a setup. But at the same time, he walked right into it knowing it could be there. You know, so it's a two-way thing there. By then, the press who jumped on this and then spread the word, they all knew he was gay. I mean, you know, he'd been pretty much out with all his friends and all his family for a couple of years. And the journalists knew, but they sort of hadn't had the green light. And George just couldn't bring himself to come out to them. I don't think it was a worrying about being gay or even people knowing he was gay. He just couldn't bring himself to talk to the media and say, I'm gay, and have them all benefit from, you know, being able to splash it all over the place. And yeah. I think in some sort of way, he was tempting fate. And he admitted later he probably was. And you know, after he did that, he made this wonderful video which laughed at the police and turned a disco into a toilet or a toilet into a disco, whatever it was.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised if he'd thought of that before he did it. You know, if he'd sit back there and thought, well, if I did get caught, I could do that.
Yeah.
So it'd be quite fun, you know.
Yeah. Okay.
There was definitely something tempting fate, tempting providence about going in the toilet and doing that. It was two things. One, it was a known gay toilet. But the other thing, it was a known place for police to go and entrap people. So it was like walking into a trap which you were warned was there.
Right.
So I think there was a lot of free thought about it. Look, he did very well out of it. He was able to come out. Now it could be open. He no longer had to cover anything up. Got a hit record out of it and enjoyed it.
And then there was a possession of marijuana, which he said, quote, this stuff makes me sane and happy.
Well,
and now, of course, it's legalized.
Where I live in Thailand, it's now no longer illegal. In most of America, it's not illegal.
And Canada, no.
I'm not someone who disagrees or disapproves of drugs. I just don't take them myself. But it's not because of a disapproval. I drink. I love drinking alcohol. I'm a monogamist. I'm faithful. I fell in love with alcohol. I don't need somebody else. I don't need another drug as well. but he really fell in love with marijuana. He seemed to smoke an extraordinary amount. He smoked it nonstop all day and all evening. But didn't seem to get very stoned from it. I think that happens with a lot of drugs. The more you take, the less effect they have. That wasn't the worst drug he was taking. While he was smoking, he was also then beginning to take other drugs which were more harmful to both to his psyche and physically.
Yeah, it was a friend that confronted him about him using crack cocaine.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how much he used these drugs, but there was definitely, he had in him a destruction element. Now, I've managed artists for 50 years, and I've never managed an artist who didn't have that in them. It's just to what degree they have it. I mean, when you're managing an artist, you know, if you've got a perfect artist, this is, oh, my God, this is the first time I've ever found an artist who didn't have self-destruct built in. You haven't spotted it, that's all. I mean, it's going to be there somewhere. And it's not always where you think it is or self-destruct in the way you think it will be. But he had it, and he loved playing this game of dare. So he would go cruising. I don't think he cared about the sex much. He just enjoyed the idea of being George Michael, famous person out. Something could happen. He could get found out. It's exciting. And that's usually what these things are about, a sort of personal game of dare. The drugs, I don't know, but they were taking him somewhere. He was finding life, boring is a quiet word, but he was finding his life difficult, and the drugs were able to take him somewhere. Perhaps a bit like the game of dare, which was more difficult to come back from. So it's like, do I dare take that, and can I still come back from it and present a sane, you know, a non-drugged face? I think it was as much testing himself, his willpower and his physicality to come back from it as it was to actually escape with it. Complex things.
But it wasn't your responsibility, I understand that, but were there occasions when you sat down and you talked to him about the fact that he might be spiraling out of control?
I wasn't managing him at that stage, but one of the things I've talked about a lot and written about is a manager is taken on by an artist to make the artist successful. You will not find a great artist who is not bipolar. That is the nature of art of all sorts, but particularly in performance art and music, is a symptom of bad mental health. So if you cure the mental health, you're going to kill the art. And this is the huge problem which both the music industry as a whole and the artists have. And the artists in general, if you suggest curing or helping, they're not very keen on you going too far with it. They know themselves. They know who they are. They know that they need their mental imbalance, if you like, to create the art. They're usually quite happy to have some medication and keep themselves quiet or under control. Mm-hmm. But they do know themselves, and they know that they don't want to become an ordinary person without this thing which helps them create. So it's a difficult area, and it's not just the manager. You know, the whole music industry, all record companies know that their main best-selling product, which supports the $60 billion a year industry, comes from bad mental health. And to cure it is to kill the product. So there's quite a conundrum for you.
Yeah, no kidding. When did he realize, and when did the people, those around him, realize that his health was beginning to fail him?
Really, it was... In 2012, I think it was, his doctor, who'd been the man to talk to, he'd been his psychiatrist and his medical doctor for 20, 25 years, his doctor died. And without question, after that, George found it difficult, because like most doctors or psychiatrists who deal with entertainment profession, they know you have to keep a balance. You can't say, you can't take any drugs. You have to find a balance. Take these ones, which will not do you so much harm, and this will help you get by, and you can still be creative, and you won't go mad. He set great faith on this doctor, Dr. Barrington Cooper. And when Dr. Cooper died, he definitely went downhill. And he was also friends with Dr. Cooper's wife, and he talked to Dr. Cooper's wife about, you know, maybe I could go and find another doctor who could replace Barry, and they talked about it, but he never did. And without that support, and he also at that stage left Kenny Goss, who'd been in his relationship for 10 years. So he neither had the support of a boyfriend nor of his long-term doctor. Right. That's really when he began to take drugs in an out-of-control way. Right. And everybody around him wanted to help him, and Elton quite famously supported him and got rebuffed by him for doing it, and Jerry Halliwell, who had been one of the Spice Girls, was also trying to help. And he didn't, you know, he was very frank when he was interviewed by that same journalist I have in the film. And that journalist asked him about his drug taking. He said, look, I know what I'm doing, and that's what I want to do.
So he died at the age of 53. And of course, as is the case with so many artists that die at a young age, people who admired their work sit back and they ask the question, how much more could he have created? What would he be doing today, 7 years later? How much did we miss out on?
At the time he died, he was working on a disco album. Now, that's not as strange as my sound, because to straight people, when you grow up and have kids, you're not going to discos. But gay people do tend to go, they keep dancing till they're 60. But it was an interesting idea that he got very into contemporary music, so it wasn't going to sound like an old-fashioned record. But my feeling is that what he did supremely well was his last tour, which is called Symphonica, is he took the great, great, meaningful songs written by other people. He did a wonderful version of Rufus Wainwright's Going to a Town, but lots and lots of songs. He really sang a magnificent set of songs in that tour. About one third were his and two thirds were other people's. He could have done that for the rest of his life. And there have been other singers who've done that. I mean, Frank Sinatra is a sort of example, except Frank Sinatra didn't write songs. But there are people like Charles Aznavour, the great French singer, who did the same thing. He sang a set of half his songs and half other people's. And he got better and better as he got older. His voice went a bit, but his emotion and his knowledge of how to deal with singing that sort of song got better. But I don't think George would have been happy with that. He didn't want to be, because that is a sense of living in the past still, or a sense of living as an old person. I don't think he wanted to face up to living as an old person. It's a different way of life from the one he'd planned always. In his plan, where he always planned everything right through his life, I don't think he'd thought of going beyond about 50.
Really? Well, he's quoted in the documentary.
I don't mean he necessarily thought, I'll kill myself at 50, I'm going to stop.
No, I understand what you're saying.
What he meant, he hadn't made a plan, and suddenly he got there and said, oh, damn me, I forgot what happens now. I'm in a mess.
Well, he's quoted in a documentary as saying, I wished I was 22, because he said that that's when he was the happiest, when he was 22.
Well, what he said was he had hated fame since he was 22. He said, since 22, I've hated fame and everything it does to you, which means you couldn't have a private life and make relationships are very insecure because you don't know if people like you because you're famous or rich or because you're generally who you are. And he obviously had been, you could see the difference. You look back at the stuff, the material of him in Wham, and there is an element of being carefree and happy and fun. I mean, I'm sure he still had some angst inside him because he was that sort of person even when he was young. But he was a carefree youngster having fun. And you didn't see that at all later. I don't think you saw it once after Wham, not that lighthearted sort of fun.
Mm-hmm. What was the final cause of his death?
Oh, when the coroner wants to fetch the bets, he said the heart stopped beating.
Yeah. Did he not have some liver issues with his liver as well?
Oh, well, he'd taken a lot of drugs in his life. And he probably drank a lot. But, the liver's very quick recovery. And he'd also been in recovery, and a month in recovery is almost enough to cure even the worst liver. So nobody really knows. It was unexpected because the 4 or 5 weeks before, he had really got back to work, and everyone who'd met him would say, God, he's wonderful. I've not seen him like this for years and years. He's happy and he's making music. But everyone who takes drugs and everyone who's bipolar has ups and downs and relapses. It's not curable. I mean, being of that nature, is always a dangerous way to live. You're up one day and down the next, and you try to keep the ups more than the downs, but it doesn't really work like that.
I listen to a lot of music that's come out in the last 40 years or whatever, and the Beatles, clearly their music will be listened to. My grandchildren will listen to the Beatles, and my grandchildren will listen to George Michael as well. Do you agree with me?
Yeah. I mean, look, I know it's probably the poppiest of all his songs, but does Last Christmas ever come on in a supermarket at Christmas when you don't enjoy it? I mean, ever. I mean, yes, you've heard it a million times, but when Marie and Carey comes on one time too often and you wish it would shut up, you don't feel that when Last Christmas comes on. I can't tell you why, but it's because whereas Maria Carey is, let's write a hit Christmas song, What Shall I Say, do-do-do-do-do, George Michael's song, despite being a Christmas song, has a sort of feeling and a lyric about it, which is serious, which is hurtful and painful. And that's why his songs are so marvelous. They can be pop, but they can have in them an element of really something which touches you in a much deeper and more serious way. And that's why they'll live on just as the Beatles songs, so exactly the same thing.
And conversely, Wake Me Up Before You Go-Go, when it comes on the radio today, I still crank it up and drive down the road like I'm 25 years old. Wake me up before you go-go. Believe me, hanging on like a yo-yo. Wake me up before you go-go. I don't want to miss it when you hit that high. Wake me up before you go-go. I love that song. And I just wrote a piece today for The Times, which is, there's another film just come out, which is just about Wham, not my film, somebody else's film. It's a very good film. And I said, he'd written these songs earlier for Wham, which were slightly political. Wham Rap, which was about young kids being on the dole and,
you know, things which are just a bit complaining, a bit part of the young agitprop type of person. And then he did Go Go. And I said, this was his coming out song, not coming out as gay, coming out as pop. You know, he suddenly said, forget all that. I just like pop music. And it is one of the finest bits of pop music ever written, I think. It's absolutely fantastic.
Yeah. A lot of great stuff. A terrific documentary. It's called The Real George Michael, Portrait of an Angel. It is streaming on several services and will be around for a long time. And I hope everybody gets a chance to, whether you're a George Michael fan or not, his life was fascinating, to say the least. He was an extremely talented person. And Simon Napier Bell, you've done a tremendous job putting it all together for us.
Thank you very much, Ted. Lovely talking to you.
Thank you very much for your time, sir.
Okay, bye.
Well, that's going to do it. Once again, thanks very much for being with us. Thank you, Becky, for all your work, and to Paul Gatt as well. These poor people, I put them through so much because I have a computer that's possessed by either the Satan or Putin. I'm not sure yet. That might be the same person. But why get political? Listen, join us again next week. And in the meantime, go online, fill out your organ and tissue donation card. You could change or even save a life. And have a great week.
The Ted Wallachin Podcast has been brought to you by Tom's Place. For the finest in men's clothing at unbeatable prices, it's Tom's Place at 190 Baldwin in the heart of Kensington Market. Tom's Place will suit you. And ETP Canada, providing estate administration with ease. The Ted Wallachin Podcast is produced by me, Becky Coles. Technical production by Paul Gatt. Music by Bike Thieves. For more information on this podcast and our sponsors, and to talk to Ted, go to www.tedwallachin.ca.